You know trouble can start when the clock hits three.
When there's no place after school for kids to be.
Nothing to do but hanging on city streets.
When mom and dad are working to make ends meet. Now it's time to beat the street.
With after school programs, city kids aren't left alone and vulnerable. They keep on learning between 3 and 6, but these programs need your support. Join with the Urban League to keep them going. Call now, because it's
time to beat the street.
Welcome to Talk New York. At first, the struggle between men and women was purely for gender equity, emphasizing the fact that both genders, men and women, are capable, rational human beings and should be treated as such. Gender issues for every decade, specifically starting from the 60s on, had focused on equality until now. There are those who say that the 90s is payback time for women who feel they have been wronged and therefore using the legal system as a tool for revenge, demanding reparation in the form of justice. It is fair to say that some of these cases deserve full legal attention, and also to acknowledge that women have traditionally suffered at the hands of abusive men while society condoned or looked the other way. However, this decade has witnessed genital mutilation by women who claim emotional distress and countless amount of legal prosecutions against men brought by women who claim rape, sexual harassment, and sexual abuse by their own partners, and men who are murdering their families, citing frustration and unfairness of the justice system as the cause of their action. What is going on? There are several groups helping to address these issues from their own perspective. One such group is the National Coalition for Men's Rights. Tonight, I am honored to welcome Mr. John Middleton, who is the Executive Director of the organization, and Mr. Tom DiRico, who is the Director of the organization. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
First of all, tell me a little bit about the organization.
The organization was started, it's going 2.5 years ago now, by two police officers who were familiar with the system, and they had gone through in the process of divorce. They were trying to see their children, and although they had court orders to see their children, they could never see their children. So they decided that if the courts do nothing, what can I do? So they formed an organization, and there have been many grassroots organizations that have been formed at that time, and they're merging together. And we are, we do have men and women. And the thing that I'd like to stress is that the children are the ones that suffer. And how the children suffer is that the non-custodial parent, which majority of times is women, they decide that they don't want the father to see the children. So they go out and they go to court, and without any proof or anything else, they just say that so-and-so punched me in the stomach and they're given an order of protection. Then, if the person decides to fight them, then they use that as a sword, saying, okay, now he called me and said he's going to kill me. Now, the police now arrest you. So now you're in family court. Then you're in criminal supreme. Then there's a divorce filed. So then you're in Supreme Court matrimony. So what happens is that if he goes to the family court and starts to fight again, he's rearrested, and now it's a felony. So men have started to back off and say, what am I supposed to do? A lot of statistics show that men do not pay child support. I think Tom
And Pataki just signed a law that is
made it a felony.
But I think we have to acknowledge that it should have been
deadbeat parents, yes, and not just fathers, because yes, there are mothers who also neglect their own children. But
if, when you see statistics of joint custodial custody, joint custody, mm-hmm, when it's imposed by the judge, which New York is the last of seven states that does not have this law, 90%+ of support is paid. Not only that, but they find both parents work more overtime because the children are involved, or the child is involved in both parents' life. And society benefits, because what you see is now the father takes life insurance because he's not ripped from the child's life. The mother does the same of the child. But the way things are now, without joint custody, and what John was saying, that the custodial parent, which in New York is 94.7% times due to the, this is from the 1993 Justice Department statistics, which is the mother, when she has custody and the child cannot have access to the non-custodial father, what happens here? The first of all, the child suffers the most. It has no man in their life to show them how men should be. Mm-hmm. Statistics will show fatherless children are 40 times more likely, the boys, to commit rape. The women are 60 times more, talking about the young girls that have no father in life, 60 times greater than a girl that does have a father in life to marry the wrong man. Because they
who
don't
is the wrong man? Isn't that how we got here to begin with?
Well,
I mean, what is going on between relationship between men and women that is bringing about this sort of war between these two groups? Because it seems like it's us against them. Is that how things have gotten?
No,
marrying the wrong man?
I was speaking in Boston a couple of months ago. And I think a 93-year-old grandmother gave me this illusion. Mm-hmm. And I kind of laugh at it. She said, but in my generation, mm-hmm, men were men and women were women.
Okay.
But today, men don't belong in the same planet with women, and women don't belong in the same planet with men.
Aren't we supposed to be from Mars and Venus?
Yes, men are from Mars, women are from Venus.
When you have a court system that just looks the other way. The family courts are open September 2nd. Mm-hmm. And I would urge everybody to go and look at the family courts. Mm-hmm. If you think...
open to the public.
Yes. If you think that you know what's going on, when you have a child services agency that interviews a child in front of the mother and says, the mother hit you, and the child says no. When you have a child services agency where a child died, and they said 3 days after that child was dead, that child is well and happy. When you have a child agency where the non-custodial parents have to be very careful, if you call child services too many times, they will charge you with neglect. Although the mayor, the governor, get on TV and say, make those calls.
Mm-hmm.
If you make them and child services decides, they will charge you with neglect. Even though they do not talk to the schools, they do not talk to the neighbors, they do not talk to the churches or the synagogues, they talk to nobody.
Is
they talk to the custodial parent.
Is it fair to say that most of these agencies and the judges also are overreacting because, or I shouldn't say overreacting, but a little more sensitive because of cases where it ended up that one person died?
No.
For instance,
no.
The man.
No. Let me. It's the exact opposite. They're only acting in a certain way. If a woman walks in and asks for a restraining order, an order of protection, she's granted it. Now, at the end of these cases, they find 95% of them were frivolous orders of protection.
The woman lied?
The woman lied.
Okay,
to get back at the men.
Can you bring perjury charges?
No, that's the problem. It's not entertained.
Well, wait a second, Tom. It's on the books.
Mm-hmm.
But you see, you have to realize something. That's up to the judge that you've been before to bring the perjury charges. I debated this past spring the Brooklyn Bar Association, and I had challenged them to give me one, just one, out of the 20,000 that were brought. There surely has to be one that you could prove beyond a reasonable doubt that was a lie, or as we say in the court of law, perjury. And she said, well, we don't prosecute because we don't want the women to be afraid.
Of what?
Of coming to us for an order of protection. I said, excuse me.
Doesn't if they sound are lying right. about it,
doesn't sound
we
right.
don't
if
want them to come,
we don't,
isn't
right.
it?
Well, right. I mean, if it's like it's nothing to go to a store and shop, but if you're going to a store and rob, you should be afraid. So the one that's making the frivolous
How easy is it for a woman to get an order of protection?
Let me give an example.
Just all you have to do is just go down to court and ask.
Watch this. This is the horror part.
Mm-hmm.
You have my name. If I give you my address, you can go down to family court in any borough and say that you live with me and I punched you in the stomach. You go ex parte. They will give you an order of protection. Then you can call up and say that I called you on the phone and I will be arrested. I don't even know you. And
then no
that's
system
easy.
Of investigation.
No. There's no system of investigation to see if you are lying.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the problem, you see, not only that, but this has been used. I'm involved 10 years fighting for children to have access to both parents.
Mm-hmm.
And the problem with this is it has become a regular game now where the lawyers are telling their clients to do this in order to keep the man away. The woman have gone through it, are telling the other woman to do it to keep the child away
is
from the father.
Is it to make the case stronger
yes.
or to keep the man
yes.
away? I think it's
both.
To make the
to both.
Mm-hmm.
Both well, happen here.
Let me
they're
ask
keeping
you
the man away so that they can have their new love in their life, be that as a mate. There's many reasons involved. To keep the child from the father is an act of vengeance and to be vindictive. To secure their own thing, saying, well, now I got the child, it's not involved in the father's life, so I don't have to worry about when the child getting older wants to live with
I
the
am
father.
Surprised about something, and I will give you a chance to mm-hmm. make your point. But what surprises me is how these men are arrested. The police will call you up, like John was saying, somebody goes to family court or to a police station, say, this person punched me, I have order of protection, blah, blah, mm-hmm. blah. The police calls him up and leaves a message or gets him and say, come, let's chat. This is a complaint that has been filed against
mm-hmm.
you. I want to chat with you. And people go in and get arrested.
Yes.
Yeah.
What should we say to people who put themselves in that
situation? They should never trust the police. When the police say, and they've said it to lawyers, well, lawyers have been shot.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, there's been a complaint against your client. Please come in and chat. So when you go in to talk, bring your toothbrush because you're going to be arrested. Even lawyers now tell their clients, don't do it. They're going to arrest you.
If you don't go, can they come to your residence
yes.
and
what
arrest
they
do, you?
Yes,
there?
But
yes.
what they do now, they have another little yeah. trick. You see,
that's simple.
If the law, if they had a warrant for you, you go to a judge and get the warrant squashed. But now what they do, what a lot of people aren't familiar with, they have what they call a pickup order.
Mm-hmm.
Now what that means, if you're ever stopped, they bring you to the police station, and then you arrest it. That's good for 7 years. Now, we see a lot of these roadblocks
if
and stuff.
If you ever stop?
If they ever stop you, whatever. A lot of the roadblocks
and stuff.
The
warrant is on the computer.
You that you are, you
well, let's say you have a broken headlight or something.
Okay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
There's no warrant. It's called a pickup order. A judge cannot squash a pickup order.
Mm.
So a lot of these roadblocks and stuff, you see how they're checking for licenses?
Mm-hmm.
They're not doing that.
Okay.
They're checking to see if there's any pickups on you or if there's any warrants. Now, a warrant, I can go before a judge and get it vacated. On a pickup order, I cannot.
What is the difference? What is a pickup?
A pickup order is that they want to talk to you.
Okay.
So they have to bring you to them.
To talk.
They don't need a warrant.
When you go in and chat, supposedly you are very trusting, and a police officer calls you to come in and chat, and you don't go with your toothbrush, your lawyer, and you chat with this person, and he said, okay, I'm putting you under arrest.
Yes.
You're staying here, and they put you through the system.
Yes.
Everything that you have said to this person, can it be used against you?
Yes, sure, it will be.
Sure.
Even if he has not read your rights when he discussed this thing with you.
Because you're already in violation of what the courts have put out as an order.
Let me give you an example of something. There's a very sad case that went by this past winter that I could not believe my eyes or my ears. This gentleman was married to his wife for 25 years. They went out, celebrated the 25th wedding anniversary, and I'm not saying he was right. He slapped her. He admitted he slapped her. She went to family court. The man stood up and said, I'm a man. I slapped her. Married 25 years.
Mm-hmm.
He went into Manhattan because he got an order of protection, threw him out of the house. He went to a florist, sent her one dozen roses, and said, and I'll never forget it, honey, I am sorry, I love you, let's talk. The woman did not want to continue with the charges. The district attorney continued with the charges, and anyway, based on that card, the man got 2 to 7 years in prison and is serving the time now.
Is that a felony?
That's a felony.
Unreal.
Because the order says you cannot call her.
What
you
if
cannot
she
communicate.
Calls you?
Well, that's okay. Not only that, which is very, I cannot understand
she
the mentality.
She has a protection against you.
Yes.
But she can call you.
Oh, yes. She can call
yes,
you.
Yes, because you don't have an order of protection against her.
She can sit outside in front of your house. Now, what the police tell you is that if you're sitting in a restaurant, she walks in, run. But yet, no, if you call the police, say, look, this woman has an order of protection against me. She's sitting outside my house. So, there's nothing we can do.
What is the recourse? If you find yourself in such a situation
There is no recourse.
Because I know of a situation where there's a quote-unquote a jilted girlfriend who has decided to file for order of protection, made allegations that the person beat her up. There are no physical evidence to prove that. She's crying rape, but that has been dropped to a misdemeanor.
Right.
This person is going to trial. What happens there? Can you go to jail with a misdemeanor?
Yes, sure, you can, up to a year. Now, this person has to demand, and I say this to everybody who's under protection, don't take any deals, because they'll give you an ACD, which is a German contemplation dismissal. They will give her order of protection for a year, so she's got a year to play this game again. When you go to court, demand a trial by jury.
Well, what I have noticed also is that even though the woman files, she can, like you were saying, can come to your house and can call you and can come to court and say that she did all those things.
Yes.
And it's not a problem.
It's not a problem.
And it's very hard for me to understand. Because how is that possible?
Well, you see, here's where there were times when women are oppressed, they still are. But it's become down to where they can use the laws now to oppress a man. You know, too many laws are no good. I think Thomas Jefferson said that. Too many laws are no good. Well, here's what happened. These laws were made to protect honest women who were being abused, and they should be protected. But if it's gotten to the point now where they can, where if the man is innocent, they could abuse the man with these laws. And that's what we're here for today.
So women are using it as a tool.
As a tool.
To sort of pay and back. Or
revenge. Or to be vindictive. Or because they're not physically stronger than their ex-partner.
Well, most of these cases are not jury trials. Are they?
Man demands a jury trial, but what happens is you go before a judge, and the judge looks you in the face and says, if you go to trial, you can get 5 to 15 years. If you plead guilty now, I'll give you 1 year.
Scare tactic.
So he gets scared. Not only that, if you go before a judge today and you say, I'm innocent, you will have to go to an attorney of the violence program and pay $25 a week. And if you don't go to that attorney of the violence program, you will go to jail. So you say, well, wait a second, I don't want to hear it. Either go there or you're going inside. You know, I do not want to hear it. That's my order. It's my order of protection. If I think, if I have a nightmare that you violate,
I think that's what I was asking you, because I think these judges are being so cautious because there have been cases where they were wrong.
I'm all for being cautious, and I'm all for punishing anybody that breaks the law and hurts another human being. It's just not a man or woman issue. Anyone that hurts a child, I'm for punishing them and imprisoning them, without a doubt. But why is not the person who's using the law to punish and hurt other human beings, why are they getting away with it? Why are they not answerable to the law? Why are they taking the constitutional rights away from another human being, oppressing them, imprisoning them, and not answering for it?
Putting them in cages.
We were talking about that on the way here. I was talking to John. They're actually literally taking another human being who did not break any law, putting them in a cage, putting them behind not only the mental distress that they're going through, the
has the justice system become a business that we have to protect?
That's what another reason they've
because
used
the
our children.
Have to arrest people to be in business.
That's right, and they're allocated more money. You have to understand something about government. It's not like business. When there's nonsense in government, what government does is applies more money to that nonsense. So now, if the courts are all backed up in litigation, they're spending $100 million because they don't want to solve the problem of custody and visitation, these restraining orders. The next year, they're allocated $110 million from the federal budget. They're allocated more money. And who is our system made of? Lawyers and judges. Well, judges are lawyers. And they went to school for what? To make money. This is their business. Mm-hmm. So they're saying, well, we're being cautious. If you're being cautious of this person's rights that took the restraining order, you must also be cautious of the person you're imprisoning. If you find out it's for no reason, then you must go after the person that filed this frivolous
charge.
And
this is our brothers, our fathers, and our children.
And the children are suffering because they don't have a father image in their life. They have no one to say, that, my father, when we went on a bus and there was a pregnant woman, my father said, son, get up, let the lady sit down. But when the father's out of the life, the children don't have anyone to say that. And then when a little girl goes into the father's life and the father says, like I tell my daughter, Tara, be careful. If a man loves you, he won't abuse you. If a man loves you, he'll wait for certain things to come his way. And that's true love. If he truly loves you, he'll wait and respect your wishes. Not that you have to respect his wishes when you go on dates. And that's how I explain it right now, too, because she's a pre-teenager. And when she gets older, I'll explain it better. But you could imagine a loving father being ripped out of that child's life. Where is the father image? Where's the saying how to be a gentleman? What does the girl have to reflect on? Mommy's boyfriends who come and go?
Because well, I have a better one yet. We have commercials on TV. Fathers, why don't you get involved in your children's lives? Great commercial. Whoever made the commercial, why don't you let the fathers get involved in children's lives? When you have 35 men a week fleeing the continental United States, they don't have the children anymore, because they can no longer fight family court, Supreme Court, matrimony, Supreme Court, criminal, when you decide I'm going to be in jail. Now, I have a problem. That if I get a parking ticket, I don't pay it, they tow my car. If I get a speed ticket, I don't pay it, they take my license. However, if there is an order of protection that's abused, the children are hurt, and this is a weapon they use, and until people get out and vote.
No, it's not. That's not the only weapon. Another weapon that they use is just to terminate the visitation.
Yes.
Now the father has to go to court, which costs 12 hours of legal time on an average, and get an order to show cause and serve it upon the custodial parent. I know a particular case where this father's fighting 9 years. He filed against the mother 13 orders to show cause because the mother terminated his visitation with his children. Now it's 13 times that the father went in front of the judge and says, judge, she's not complying with the order. I'm here. She gave no reason for this. I'm here to get my visitation back. At least because it's been doctored around. She says, well, the kid gained weight, or the kid had dirt under its fingernails. I didn't like the way the kid came back. One father, they said the kid smelled the smoke. The father didn't even smoke. All right.
We almost out of time, so I'm going to try and give people information
okay,
out
yes.
there. How can your group help people out there? What kind of advice would you give them?
Well,
how do you become a member
well, because
of the National Coalition?
All right,
what we do is we're at 50 Court Street in Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
We have a phone number, 718-624.
And you have women involved in this.
Yes.
Oh, yes. And what's the amazing thing is that the women are abused, too.
Mm-hmm.
By the order of protections.
Mm-hmm.
By the custodial father.
The custodial
it's not a gender
father.
Thing.
Are the right people getting the order of protection?
No. Absolutely not.
95% are using it just to keep the parent away from the children.
Okay. So if you have found yourself in this situation, you are in criminal court,
mm-hmm.
and family court is getting involved, that's another thing. I find it very interesting that mm-hmm. the person has been arrested and going through the system for abuse, and then mm-hmm. they want the person to pay child support,
mm-hmm.
you paying your lawyer to go through this
yes.
system, and now you have to pay child support.
Yes.
I don't get that.
Well, that's why they say a lot of
but
fathers.
What should you do if you have found yourself?
Give us a call. because there are many men that we have and women that have been through this. Mm-hmm. And there are things that you can do. There are other organizations we can put you in contact with mm-hmm. that will go after the judges who mm-hmm. do not follow orders.
Okay.
That there are children's advocate groups that we can put you in touch with. And the thing is, two rules. Number one, plead guilty if you're guilty. But if you're not guilty, don't even think about 1 second of community service, because this will come back to haunt you.
Yes.
And if you're in a situation, we show people how to pair up with other people so that their time is accountable for it. To go visit the police station, go visit the court, make yourself known here or there, and keep a log so that you demand
if
the time.
If someone wants to get in touch with you, what is the number to call?
They can call 718-624-7666, or they can beep us at 917-329-1000. And that's 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Because unfortunately, you know, you don't get arrested.
So you have ex-police officers as part of this group. Do you have any legal people?
Yes.
Yes. We even have lawyers. We don't recommend lawyers as per se this particular lawyer, but mm-hmm. we do help with legal work, and we will let our members know if they're being exploited by their lawyer. Now the lawyers don't like that, but that's tough.
Well, we have two attorneys that we use a lot. Should I say their names?
Yes, please.
Okay. There is Alan Stutman, who's also at 50 Court Street. He's in the phone book. I don't know his number offhand. And there is Richard Grady. They're also there. Now, they have seen enough from us to know of what's going on. And what they do is they can also be contacted 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. They have beepers. Mm-hmm. And they go to work for you. And when I say go to work for you, they give you a discount. And they already know the system because they've handled so many orders of protection. And
so they can help you
yes.
out. On that note, we almost out of time, mm-hmm. and I just wanted to say something. If anybody, if a policeman calls you and say, come, let's chat, he's not your friend, go with a lawyer. Okay? This program is not to say that people who have been abused shouldn't use the legal system, but it is to say that we should use it for the right things. It's not there to serve as a tool for revenge, but to use it legitimately so that frivolous cases, we could identify and throw them out and
That's
use
right.
it wisely. On that note, what would you like to say before we leave?
I want to say to those, don't give up your children. Fight. Fight hard. They're your children. Life is short and they need you. The most helpless mammal on the face of this earth is a human child. And the child needs both parents. Don't give up.
And I would like to say that just remember, you have a vote. Write your senators, write your congressmen, write the President of the United States, write the Attorney General of the state,
and
stop the abuse.
All right. On that note, I would like to thank you very much for being
thank
here, John Middleton.
Oh, thank you.
And Tom,
thank you
very much for being. This is Yajima Okwampahofe for Talk New York. Thanks for watching. Good night.
Major.
Drown your campfires with water, then stir and drown again.
We know we have the news to do with
Only you can prevent forest fires.
In America, you are not required to offer food to the hungry or shelter to the homeless. There is no ordinance forcing you to visit the lonely. In fact, nowhere in the Constitution does it say you have to provide anything for anybody. Thank you for all you've given. Imagine what more could do.